Come on, let's keep praising. Come on, let's keep shouting. I don't know about you, but I know that you didn't come to Fresh Start Church to have a normal service. Stop trying to be normal. Some of you are trying to fit in, and you'll never fit in with the fire of God. God has not raised this house up to fit in with the rest of the American culture. God is calling a remnant of people that say, we don't want games. We don't want average. We don't want normal. We don't want complacency. We came tonight desperate for the fire of God. We came tonight desperate for the power of God. What's going to save your marriage? What's going to save your family? What's going to save your community? It won't be a golf clap. It won't be an apathetic praise. It won't be a half-hearted, a back and forth, McDonald's smile Christianity. God is longing to raise up a people that say, I could care less what anybody thinks. You didn't save me. You didn't deliver me. I'm going to praise like I've never praised. I'm going to shout like I've never shout. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the earth tremble, for the day of the Lord is approaching. I hear the sound of trumpets. I hear the sound of the voice of the archangel saying, this is your moment. Stop letting it pass you by. This is your moment. Don't sit back like you've done every week. Last night's praise isn't going to work for tonight's breakthrough. Last week's shout isn't good enough for what God wants to do. I'm done. Some of us in this room don't know why we can't get full of the Holy Ghost. Friend, the Holy Ghost will not fill you if you're already full of yourself. And there are too many of us in this place tonight that are going to choose preferences, going to choose comfort zones, if as loud as I could get, brother, going to choose apathy over the presence of God. How far are you willing to go to say, God, I don't just need you for a moment, but God, if I don't have your presence, if I don't have your anointing, if I don't have your power, David said, who do I have in heaven but you? It's not about the streets of gold. It's not about the seraphim. It's about God. It's about the one that sits on the throne. There is one man that we come to praise. There is one man that we come to worship. And your praise wasn't free. Do you have to praise that way? You don't have to praise that way. You get to praise that way. I look at some of you, what you got delivered from, and that's how you praise him. I look at the drug addiction, the apathy, the anger, the suicide, the fact that you should have died in that car accident, the fact that you should have died in that relationship, the fact that you should have died when that motorcycle, you went right off the edge, the fact that you should have died in the hospital when they said, we don't understand how you're still alive, but it was a strong arm of God that says, I'm not going to leave you where I found you. This is not an add Jesus to your Sunday morning. This is every day of my life saying, God, there's a reason why I praise you this way. There's a reason why I shout this way. If it had not been for your power, if it had not been for your mercy, if it had not been for your anointing, I wouldn't be here. Some of you forgot where you've come from. Some of you forgot that first fire. Jeremiah said, I want to quit, but there's something on the inside of me that fuels me. There's something on the inside of me that drives me. He said, there is a fire that is shut up in my bones that I'm weary of holding in. I wonder if there's anyone in this house that says, Isaiah, I couldn't shut up about God if I tried. I couldn't stop singing about him if I tried. It was his power. It was his mercy. It was his grace. It was his love. It was the anointing of the Holy Ghost. It wasn't religion that delivered me. It wasn't church that saved me. It was the presence and the power of Almighty God. And if he did it once, he's going to do it again. you so much. Can you please give it up for the worship team? Was the devil complacent when he was destroying your life as much as I could get, brother? Thank you. Was the devil, you could take your seat but stay standing on the outside, inside. Was the devil complacent when he stole from you? Is he complacent when he took from us? Friend, I look at the way the enemy is ravaging the American church, and I wonder if we had half as much passion as the enemy's kingdom, if we were half as loyal as the gangs of Arizona, if we were half as committed to the kingdom of God as we used to be, the kingdom of the enemy. I'm telling you tonight, friend, if the devil wasn't apathetic when it came to destroying your life, we as a church should not be apathetic when it comes to destroying the kingdom of darkness. If the enemy's committed, where's the commitment in the body of Christ? Where are those that say, I'm going to be as faithful for God as I was the enemy? I'm going to be as passionate. We get saved in the church and we have half as much excitement and half as much passion as we used to have at the club. Some of you praise at the football game but don't praise in the house of God. And you say, oh, preacher, why are you up there shouting and offending? And I'm going, why are you down there dying? Friend, I'm telling you that when you get over yourself, when you say, God, see, this whole thing is more than just praying a prayer. The Bible says, if any man comes after me, he must lay down his life. He must let go of his life. And there are too many people in the church that are hanging on to what God is saying, let go of. And you go, God, why aren't you blessing me? God, why aren't you anointing me? God, where is your fire? According to the word of God, the fire of God, it only falls on sacrifice. If there is no fire on the inside of your life, then maybe there's no sacrifice. This is not a one-night stand type of religion. This is a commitment that you say, I'm not just going to shout once a month at revival, but I'm going to shout every single day. I'm going to shout on Monday. I'm going to shout on Tuesday. What would happen if we came to church having praised all week long? See, sometimes you can't wait on somebody else to stir you up. You have to learn how to stir yourself up. You have to stop letting other people fight your battles, other people praise for you, other people shout for you, other people, oh, so-and-so will just do it. No, you have to look yourself in the mirror and say, it's my job to pray for people. It's my job to shout unto God. It's my job to cast out devils. It's my job to raise the dead. It's my job to preach the gospel, and I'm done making excuses. I'm going to start making disciples. I'm done waiting around for somebody else to do what God has called me to do. I'm called to preach the gospel. I'm called. We come once a week and hear other people's stories with God. Maybe one day I'll be able to preach like Isaiah. Maybe one day I'll have a pulpit. Friend, your pulpit is the Starbucks that you work at. Your pulpit is the Walmart. Come on, help me as much as you can, brother. Your pulpit is the Walmart that you work at. It's the grocery store that you work at. It's the fast food place that you work at. And so many of us are waiting to come to church before we get excited about God. What is the point of being excited about a God that everyone in the room knows about? What is the point when the only time you share your faith is when you talk to people more on fire than you and tell them to calm down and be like you? I don't want to be like you. You want to know why? Because when sick people get around you, they leave sick. When dead people get around you, they leave. I had pastor, why don't you just calm down? And why don't you just chill out? And why do you have to pray? I had one pastor tell me, if you didn't preach so much on repentance and say sin so much and talk about hell so much, you could just be big and you could speak at all these big conferences. I said, no, if I stop doing all that, I'll be like you. And I don't want to live my life in the American religious church that doesn't heal the sick, that doesn't raise the dead, that doesn't cast out devils. I want to be a part of a place where the dead get raised, where the sick get healed, where prophecy goes forth, where they come in on mats and they leave running, where there's real change. Where it's not come as you are and stay as you are, it's come as you are but leave different. See, devil doesn't care that you come and fall over and get up and you're still addicted to porn as much as you can, brother. The devil doesn't care that you come and you fall over and we speak in a little bit of tongues, but no one gets changed. See, the devil says it's okay to shout in church. It's okay to praise in church. It's okay to pray in church. It's okay to witness to church. Just make sure you don't do it outside. That's why Pharaoh told the children of Israel, you can worship God, just do it in Egypt. Just live your life in the world. And then when you feel like worshiping and you feel like praising and you feel like shouting and you feel like screaming, but God says, I'm going to raise a people that are going to do it outside the church, not just inside the church. I'm going to raise a people that would begin to open up their mouths about the gospel. I think about what would have happened if somebody didn't tell me about this God. What would have happened if someone didn't come to me and say, Isaiah, there's a God that could save you. There's a God that could change you. There's a God that could deliver you. Somebody had to open their mouth. See, because we're sitting around going, oh, God's going to do it for us. We come into prayer meetings, and I'm not bashing. I love prayer meetings. We have 3 prayer meetings a week at the revival that I run back at home. And we say, oh, God, save the city. God does not save buildings. God saves people. And we're the answers to the prayers we're praying. And we're praying, saying, God, would you do this? And God says, I already did it on the cross. It's your job. It is not my job to go witness to all your friends. It's not my job to go pray for all your friends. It's not my job to heal. He said, I've given you the authority. I've given you the fire. I've given you the power. I've given you the same spirit that raised Christ Jesus is living on the inside of you. You don't have a weak spirit. You don't have an apathetic spirit. You have the same spirit, and the church needs to begin to act like our God is alive. Our God did not stay in the grave. Our God is more exciting than spring training. Our God is more exciting than the latest movie. Our God is more exciting than the latest craze. I am done living my life depending on somebody else to fight what God has called me to fight. I don't need to praise, then you don't need breakthrough. If you don't want deliverance tonight, if you don't want healing tonight, if you don't want breakthrough tonight, just keep doing what you've been doing for the last 15 years, and you'll fulfill the prophecy that the writer of Hebrews talks about. He says, you've been believers for so long, yet by now you should be teaching people. He said, you've just come to church, and you've been a spectator in the house of God. God is not looking for more people to come and watch. That's why when he preached in John and offended everybody, and everybody walked away, he said, Peter, are you going to leave too? See, there is a temptation to walk away from revival because we don't always understand what's going on. But I felt the Holy Ghost speak to me during worship saying, fresh start, we have nothing to go back to. We have burned every bridge. We have left every mark. We have left every sign of the past. We are living in revival. When's the revival going to end? When the trumpet sounds and the clouds open and Jesus comes back. Revival is not a once a week thing. Revival is not just for one day. It's every single day. It is a lifestyle that we walk in. Going to the revival, you are the revival. If no one's getting raised that's dead around us, we can't say we're a revival. The Bible says if we claim to live in the light but live our lives in spiritual darkness, the truth is not in us. Here's the deal, friend. We claim to be Christian. We claim to live our lives. There's days where I've convinced myself I'm more on fire than I really am. That's why Jesus said to the church of Sardis, you have a reputation of being alive, but you're really dead. See, some of us have a reputation that we are a Christian, but we're not really a Christian. Jesus said, many will stand before me and say, Lord, Lord, Lord. In other words, I've confessed with my mouth, he's the Lord of my life. Did we not prophesy? And I'll say, here's the problem. You did miracles. You did signs. And you prophesied. He said, but I never had a real connection. You were not excited about me on the Thursday night. You were not excited about me on Friday afternoon. You were not excited about me Sunday at the family reunion. He said, you had a form of godliness, but you've denied the very power that can make you like God. Every time I'm out in this world and I'm not sharing my faith and I'm not reaching the people that God has called me to reach, I'm denying them an encounter with God, and I'm denying God access to my life. He says, you deny me on earth, then I'll deny you before my Father in heaven. That wasn't when people say, are you Christian? You say, no, I'm not a Christian. The That's when you see people that need God, and God wants to use your life and use you as access, an access point from heaven to earth. And you say, no, God, you can't use me. Why? Because I'm too tired, because I'm too this. And we have all these excuses. Yet Jesus canceled every excuse when he went to the cross and said, I'm not just going to die for your sin, but I'm going to die as your sin. Every excuse that you had, he put up on that cross. So I have no excuse why I'm not excited. I have no excuse why I shouldn't praise. I have no excuse why I shouldn't be hungry. I have no excuse to be apathetic. There are people in this room that are too afraid of being radical. They're afraid that I'm just too radical. I'll tell you, on Judgment Day, there's not one person in this room that God's going to say, you did too much. He says, Isaiah, don't be legalistic. Legalism is the last problem we're having in the American church. Legalism says we're doing too much, and God's saying we're not doing enough. And Paul says, here's how I did more. He said, it was by the grace of God that I am what I am. He said, and God's grace was not in vain. In other words, I'm not wasting the grace of God, living a lukewarm, apathetic existence where I go from service to service to service, asking people that have paid a price to pray for me, to prophesy over me, and to lay hands on me. But I'm going to go into the secret place under the shadow of the Almighty, and I'm going to get my own oil. That is why when David was going to go to battle, oh, come on, y'all need to help me. I know y'all are a lot louder than that. I heard you last night for Josh. Come on, help me. I know I'm not as loud. You know what I'm saying? Come on, help me preach. I got a little bit less voice in me. Saul said, David, I want you to wear my armor. People say, what does that represent? We all know it represents tradition. We all know it represents religion. We all know, but here's what it really represented. Saul's armor looked different than everyone else's armor. Saul was the king. His armor was painted different. His armor looked different. Here's what Saul had in his mind. He had the same thing so many in the American church had in their mind. He said, I'm going to get David to wear my armor so that when David goes out on the battlefield, everybody will be standing miles away, and they'll see David walk out, and they will think it's Saul. They won't think it's David. And I'll send David to fight something that I'm too afraid to fight. And then I'll try and get credit for what David was willing to war against. See, some of you are in this house and you want to get credit for somebody else's labor. You want to get credit for somebody else's warfare. There are demonic powers that are in your life that I can't fight. And you're going to have to put your big boy pants on. You're going to have to take the pacifier out and put the diapers down. And say, I got a sword. I got a shield. Come on, brother, as loud as you could give me. I'm going to fight. I'm not going to sit around trying to take credit for somebody else's prayer life. God's going to stand you naked before him and say, what did you do for my kingdom? Well, I was a part of Fresh Start Church. I didn't ask you about Fresh Start Church. They already have their reward. What did you do for my kingdom? Well, God, I was busy. Really, Paul was the busiest man in human history, and he prayed without ceasing. Well, God, I just didn't, you know, I was afraid. I didn't give you a spirit of fear. I gave you a spirit of power, of love, a sound mind. I didn't give you a timid spirit. See, when you're apathetic and you shrink up, even in the house of God, and you're even offended right now, it's not you that's offended. It's the enemy that does not want you to break out of the religious bondage that he's held you in for so long. And you've gotten so comfortable with your chains. You worship with your chains on. You bring your chains to the altar. You love your chains. And God says, you need to stop being comfortable with not having a prayer life. It needs to make you uncomfortable. The fact that you've spent more hours on Netflix this last week than in the presence of God. It needs to make you uncomfortable that you spend more time on Facebook than in his book. It needs to make us uncomfortable that we are bowing down before the idols of this world and then come in the church and wondering where God is. God, I don't know why you're, where are you, God? God goes, where are you? You haven't been there praying on Monday. You haven't been praying on Tuesday. You don't pray at all. What kind of relationship with no communication, with no passion, without reading the word? See, a lot of us are getting our lunch stolen every day by the devil because Jesus fought the devil in the wilderness. He didn't fight the devil with what his pastor preached on Sunday. He didn't fight the devil with what Isaiah Saldivar tweeted out the week before. He didn't fight the devil off the latest book that he bought at the Christian bookstore. He didn't fight the devil based on all the podcasts and all the Christian lingo and all the Christian charades and chores we do. He looked at the enemy enemy and said, there is one weapon that I have against darkness. He said, it is written. Here's the problem in our generation. We don't know what's written. We know every player on our favorite team, yet we don't know who Habakkuk is. We don't know who Hezekiah is. We don't know who Joel is. We don't know the story of Job. And you could quote every player and every stat and every movie star and who won every Grammy. But what about the Word of God? We need the Bible to have revival. We need a fresh fire with the Word of God. The enemy comes and his lie is believable because we don't know the truth. I was such a liar when I was in the world. I was 19 years living like the devil, living for myself. And every night I would go to my girlfriend's house, and I hate admitting this, but I need to use this story. And I would go out and party and sleep around and do all this stupid stuff. And the next day, it never failed. She would call me and go, oh, honey, where were you? Oh, what were you doing last night? Oh, nothing. You know, I just went straight home after I left your house at 10 o'clock. I was lying. Why did I have such confidence in all of my lies, never getting caught? What made me such a confident liar? Here's what gave the lie power. See, the only way a lie has power is one fact. The fact was, I knew that she did not know the truth. And as long as she didn't know what I really did, as long as she was unaware of the truth, my lie had more validity and power. I was a confident liar. I knew I could tell her whatever I wanted to tell her, and she was going to believe me. And then all of a sudden, one day I said, oh yeah, I came home. And she goes, that's not what so-and-so told me. Wait, what do you mean? Yeah, Rebecca was at that party you were at last night. And all of a sudden, I'm mad, I'm sweating, I'm upset. Why? Because somebody told her the truth. And the moment somebody came and told her the truth, I was mad at the person for telling her the truth, because the truth that that person told her stripped my lie's power. See, the thing in you that's angry right now, it's not the Holy Spirit. It's not God. It's the one that's living and lying to you, saying, you don't have to shout that way. You don't have to praise that way. You don't have to witness to people. You don't have to be passionate. That's not a call for every believer. That's a good saying. But my Bible says that these signs shall follow them that believe. This is the call. Come on, brother, way louder for every single believer to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cleanse the lepers, to cast out devils, to preach the gospel. He's not asking us. He commands us. And let me just give you prophetically what I'm seeing happen in the American church. The church won't do what God's called them to do. He's coming to pastors, and they're saying, we're too busy with our programs, our picnics, our parties, and our outreaches. We don't want prayer meetings. We want board meetings. We don't want prayer condition. We want air condition. We're not concerned with how comfortable you are. We're concerned with how comfortable they are. And so God is going to the door of the American church, and like the book of Revelation chapter 3 says, he stands outside the door of the church. That is why people are coming to church one way, and they're leaving the same way. There is little change happening in the American church. And I had a nice cute message planned, but I feel the spirit of prophecy. We have people coming in the church, and they are bound, and they are hurting, and they are addicted, and we are lacking the very power. The only thing we have as a church is the power of God. The only thing we have going for us is the presence of God. Jesus looked at the disciples and said, wait in Jerusalem until you get the Holy Ghost. You cannot do what I've called you to do without the Holy Ghost. You cannot do what I've called you. Speaking in tongues once a week is not going to get our family saved. Giving 5%, giving Applebee's more of our income than giving the house of God is not going to see revival. And if you're mad at God for not moving in your life, you should be mad at yourself for not moving in his life. People backslide pastor all the time. I came to your revival. I came to your church, and I just really didn't get nothing from it. It's because you didn't give nothing to it. Don't get mad that you're not getting blessed when you're not blessing other people. See, we've taught in the church that this is all for you. This isn't for you. This is for the world. Jesus said, Abram, I'm going to bless you. But don't get it twisted, Abram. Don't be selfish. I'm not blessing you for you. I'm blessing you to bless the nations. There is one purpose and one intention for everything we're doing at this revival. And it's not in reach. It's outreach. It's God saying, I want to send you out into the four corners of the earth. And I want you to preach the gospel. I want you to be a participator and not a spectator. There is real change that comes in the presence of God when you get over yourself and say, I've spent too many days making reasons why I can't worship, reasons why I can't witness, reasons why I don't pray for the sick, reasons why I don't make disciples, reasons why if I thought back to the last 30 days, I've not witnessed to one person. And then here's the problem. We come to church. Oh, Jesus, you're the greatest thing in the world. And God goes, then why don't you tell anyone about me? And then we come to Pastor, I don't know why none of my friends want to be Christian. And I'm like, I know why. Because you're constantly upset. You don't give. You're not happy. You don't have joy. I don't have nothing to be happy about. Joy has nothing to do with the circumstance. It has everything to do with happiness is an emotion based on circumstance. Joy says, I don't care if I can't pay the bills. I don't care if nothing's working out. I don't care if I have sickness in my body. He died for me so I could live my life full of joy, full of purpose, and full of peace. And here's the scariest reality. If you don't want to be used by God, he'll find somebody else to use. See, we teach in the church, oh, you know, God just loves you, and he does love you. Don't get it twisted. Don't twist what I'm saying. And God just wants to use you, and it's okay. Just kind of let God work on you. Friend, we don't preach about the God that will pass you by and say, I'm not going to use you any longer because you're apathetic, you're complacent, and you don't want to do what I've called you to do, and I'll go find somebody else that does. One of the saddest verses in the entire Bible is in the book of Acts when it said, and they found a replacement for Judas. Friend, if you don't think God could find a replacement for you, if you don't think there's somebody else out there that has more money than you, that has more talent than you, that has more obedience than you, if you don't want the fire, if you don't want the passion, I'm trying to be nice. If you don't want the call of God, if you don't want the anointing of God, God will go find somebody that's out in the middle of nowhere, addicted to heroin, and say, that's going to be the leader in this next move of God. That's going to be the one I use. That's going to be the one I call. Is it biblical? Absolutely. The Bible says, and he sends out the invitation. And why did the people not come to the revival? Why did they not participate? Why did they not live a lifestyle of revival? They said, well, I just got married. Well, I have a job. Well, I just bought property. They let the pleasures and the distractions, the Netflix, the Facebook, yes, I'm talking to you. I'm not preaching to the person next to you. I'm not preaching to your cousin Tony that should have came to the revival. I'm talking straight to you. We have allowed the idols of this world to cloud the fire of God. We have allowed the things of this world to get in the way of the call of God. I'm not saying, oh, it's what's wrong with it, brother. I'm not asking what's wrong with it. I'm asking what's right with it. People are like, I can't bring my kid to the revival. I gotta take him to a football game. Is how far he throws a football gonna matter in 100 years? Friend, I have nothing against sports. I play softball. I love sports. I think it's all great. Here's what I have a problem with. When you spend more time on things that do not matter in eternity, and you don't spend any time on what matters, and then you stand before God, and your reward is going to be a pile of ashes. The Bible says in Corinthians, all of your work gets tested to see if there's value. And then we're going to stand before God, and God's going to look at a pile of dust and say, you chose that over me? You chose dust over my presence. You chose a Netflix series. You chose a movie. You chose the culture. And I know there's going to be some of you that say, God, it might hurt on earth. It might cost me something on earth. But I'm not selling out for a cheap, easy gospel. If our Christianity is easy, it's not Christianity. If our Christianity is not, if there's no persecution, friends, some of us have no persecution. Everybody just likes me, probably because you're not following Christ. Jesus said this, woe unto the man that everyone speaks well of. I love when people come, oh yeah, so-and-so said this about you. I'm like, praise God. If they weren't talking about me, I probably not doing what Christ. And it's you don't have, and you know what's the crazy part? When you're preaching the word and following the gospel, you don't even have to try to offend people. The word of God will offend people all on itself. If we're preaching the word and people are not getting convicted, they're not getting challenged, and they're not getting offended, we are preaching another gospel. And Paul himself said, let a curse fall on any man, even an angel that preaches another gospel. The Bible says the word of God God is sharp, it's alive, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, and it splits soul from spirit, joint from marrow, and it judges the intentions and the thoughts of man. That word judge is used one time in all of the Bible in the Greek, and the word literally means whose business or special gifting is to judge something. Here's what Jesus is telling us. He's saying the sole purpose of the Word of God, its business and special gift, is to judge the sin of man, is to look at our thought life, is to look at how we live our lives and say, I'm not on the right road. I could praise, I could pray, I could give and still be on the broad road. But God has called you to return back to your first love before He passes this nation by. There's coming a day, according to the scripture, where God says, enough is enough. I'm done playing games with the American church. You've laughed in my face. You've mocked me. You've made me look like a joke to the rest of the nations. People have more respect for Catholicism. They have more respect for Islam. They have more respect for Mormons, for Jehovah's Witnesses. And they laugh at the American church because we preach a gospel that has no change, that has no conviction. It is a costless cross that people are not trying to follow because it's cheaper than a lawn chair in our front yard and more plastic and more synthetic. But God is raising up a group that say, we are not giving people a fake gospel, and we are not allowing you to pass us by. We are going to pray. We're going to seek. We're going to fast. We're going to be more committed than we've ever been. We want God, not the God of the American church, the God of the Bible. We see blind eyes open, and we all, you know what scared me? I got radically saved. Within 6 months, there was 600 people showing up to my house. You can go look online, pictures and videos. 600 people showing up to my house. Not Christians, not people from other churches, people from all over different parts, people from all over the world, people from the streets, and they were coming saying, Isaiah, we've never heard of an encounter like this. We've never seen miracles like this. How sad is it when we have churches on every corner, yet no one's seeing miracles? Churches on every, over 100 churches in my city, and people have to come to a house because there's no miracles happening in the church. There's no deliverances. You know what the churches of our city tell people? Oh, you're addicted to drugs? Go to the Awakening. They deal with people like you. Oh, you have demons? Go to the Awakening. They deal with people like you. And the church, whose very purpose was to bring in the broken, the hurting, and the lost, and to save and change and deliver them, is turning away the very people that God is bringing in. Our whole generation is obsessed with transformation. The number one hashtag trending is Transformation Tuesday. Everybody wants to know, how do I change? How do I look different? What am I here for? What is my purpose? And we are answering questions that they're not even asking. Well, this is what you should dress like. This is what you should do on Sunday. This is how, and they're going, I'm not asking. I'm asking, what is my purpose on the earth? And if our purpose for them on the earth is go to church once a week, we've missed the mark. Just come to church. Here's what my drug addicted friends want to know. What do I do on Monday? Oh, we haven't that far ahead yet. Just come back next Sunday. Well, what do I do on Tuesday? Because we used to drink every single day, and now you just want us to come to church once a week and sing songs with a bunch of people that go to the same club as us? Sing songs with a bunch of people, the only time they fight is on Facebook? I'm looking for people that say, I'm laying everything down. Do people want, here's the question that we have to ask ourselves. And don't worry, I'm preaching again tomorrow night, and we're gonna have an amazing service of Pastor Zane in the morning. You're gonna get plenty of revelation. We have to ask ourselves this. Do people want what I have? Are the people around me ridiculously attracted to the God that lives inside of me? Or is there another Jesus, a God that I've made in my image instead of a God that made me in His image? Am I serving a God that looks like me, that talks like me, that wants to fulfill my desires and my pleasures? Or have I laid down my life fresh and said, God, I want you to wound me. I want your word to pierce me. We need some holiness preaching back in the American church. We need some people that would tell it like it is and stop beating around the bush. Well, you know, one day, no, you don't have to wait one day. Today's the day of salvation. Why am I not receiving? Because I'm not asking. Jesus told him in John 16, he's about to die. They still don't understand who he is. They still don't know what's going on. And Jesus said this. He said, the problem with you is you've not asked for anything up until this moment in my name. He said, if you ask me, you're going to receive. The problem I've come to find is everybody wants to talk about the ask. Everybody wants to talk about the receive, but nobody wants to talk about the process in between the ask and receive. See, it might only take me 5 seconds to say ask and receive, but it takes 5 months sometimes. It takes 5 years sometimes to get the ask and the receive. And there are so many people that quit revival because of disappointment. What does disappointment mean? I'm glad you asked, Wall. Disappointment means when you miss an appointment. It means I thought one thing and I received another thing. I thought God was going to heal me here. I thought God was going to save my wife. I thought God was going to deliver my children. I thought God was going to deliver my marriage, and it hasn't happened yet. And it's the process between the ask and the receive where the enemy wants to come in and lie to you and discourage you and say, God isn't going to do what he said he'd do. This revival isn't going to see what God said you'd see. And I came to tell the devil that he is a liar, to keep asking, to keep believing. That's why we came tonight, to ask God, say, God, would you give us this city? Come on, brother, way more. God, would you revive our marriages? God, would you restore our children? But we're mad he's not answering prayers we're not asking. I don't know why you haven't done it yet. God says, how much time have you spent praying for that? When God picks up our prayer transcript in heaven, how much time have we literally spent praying for the move of God? I get mad at God all the time. God, I don't know why you didn't save my ex-girlfriend. You didn't save my friend. And God says, you spent 15 minutes in the last 8 months praying for those people. And you spend hours in front of your TV and iPhone, and you spend 90% of your life with your neck down, wondering why we all have neck pain. And then we have prophets that are really not prophesying or prophesying, and they come in here, I just sense somebody has neck pain. I got a word of knowledge. Everybody has neck pain because everybody's addicted to their smartphones. Hold on, the Lord's giving me a word, back pain. Duh, we all have back pain. 90% of the American church is dealing with back pain. Praise God, someone help us. Why is the enemy so content with me doing this? Because when I'm doing this, I'm not asking. When I'm doing this, I'm not witnessing. When I'm doing this, I'm not evangelizing. When I'm doing this, I'm not casting out devils. When I'm doing this, I'm not talking to people. What am I doing? I'm escaping into a fantasy world where I'm seeing everybody's highlight reel, and I'm comparing my back behind the scenes to their highlight, and I'm angry why my life doesn't look like their life. You want to know why your life doesn't look like their life? Because their life doesn't look like their life. Because they're only posting the highlights of their life, and you're spending your life frustrated. Why don't I have a big ministry like I said? You don't know the hell that we had to go through to get the, there we go. Come on, way up to get the ministry. I wish I had an orphanage. If you knew how much time and how much energy and how much money someone in the ministry helped me preach that we had to put in to what God wants to do, there is a real price to the move of God. There is a real price between your ask and receive. But God is saying to us tonight, don't quit in the process. Don't quit in the journey. That's what makes you strong. That's what strengthens you for the road. That's what equips you for the call. It's the process that prepares you for the promise. But because our generation is instant, I want it now. You can't have it now. You don't get fruit unless you first sow. We're all angry. Why is there no fruit in my life? Because there's no seeds in your life. Because you don't come to prayer, you don't fast, you don't give. You're not excited about the move of God. The only time we're passionate is when somebody begs us to be passionate. We didn't have to beg you when you were doing a cake stand back in the world. We didn't have to beg you to go get ready to go to the club. It was funny because at 9 o'clock we started getting ready to go to the club, and at 9 o'clock we're looking at watch going, I don't know what this preacher thinks. Doesn't he know that I got to get to Applebee's after? I got to beat the Baptist church and I just need to get into the buffet? Friend, you got to get real with yourself and say, why was it that I had endurance in the kingdom of darkness, but I'm weak in the kingdom of God? There were days where I was drunk for 15 hours straight. Now we're 8. I'm tired. I got to go to bed. It's 9 o'clock. Friend, we have lost. We have lost our way. We have lost our passion. We have lost our zeal. And I would question if we really know the God that we claim to know. What would happen if we got so lit on fire tonight that I didn't sleep for 3 full days when I experienced the fire of God. I didn't sleep 3 days. I didn't eat for 2 weeks. I lost over 30 pounds. I got rid of everything in my house. I came home, got rid rid of every TV. I got rid of every movie. My mom's going, what are you doing with our flat screen TV? I said, Mom, I'm building a temple so that the presence of God could dwell in this house. And I'm going to get rid of everything in my life that doesn't glorify God. Oh, are you preaching legalism? No, I'm preaching the cross. I'm preaching lay it down to everything. You know what the Greek word for everything is? Everything. I just don't know. If you don't know, get rid of it. Is this okay? If you're asking the question, it's already wrong. Get rid of it. Well, what if I get rid of something that's sinful? We're afraid of getting rid of what God told us to get rid of. See, the enemy will always talk you out of what God wants you to give up tonight. Why? Because he doesn't want you to receive what you're asking for. So in the process, he spends his time discouraging you, spends his time. That's why Jesus said when you pray, he says, I'm going to leave John 16. He said, it's going to be like a woman in labor. The woman goes through pain. She goes through trials. She goes through, oh, come on, help me. I got two kids. And she hurts and she's groaning. And she goes, this is the worst thing. Would you just unplug the machine? I'm going, it's pain medication. You're not my sweat. Would you just, my wife went crazy. Here's the deal. The Bible says that once the baby comes, she forgets the pain in childbirth. See, the pain of seeing your friend unsaved, the pain of seeing this community addicted to drugs, the pain of seeing your marriage go through it, the pain of seeing your kids backslide, it hurts now. But the moment that promise comes, the moment you birth what God has called you to birth, all the pain goes away. You forget about the pain, you forget about the process, and you look at that thing and say, this is what I've been waiting for. Some of you are about to receive what you've been asking, but you have to faint not. You have to get that fire and let it fuel you. You're going to make it. You know the best way to prevent you from ever backsliding? Not be able to backslide. People say, you ever think you're ever going to backslide? I'm going to what? Backslide to vomit? See, you don't remember your life before you met God. That's why you come to church. Oh, praise God. I got to get in. I got to get out. I don't want to share my faith. I don't want. You've been talking for a year and a half about that promotion where you got a $2 raise, yet we can't get you to share about the power of God that changed everything. How could we say we have the answer to the world if we can't tell anybody the answer that we have? How could we say we're radical? Friend, I don't just want to be radical in the house of God. I want to be radical in the marketplace. When the call goes out, he says, if you don't want to come to the banquet, send the invite out to the world. Send it to the poor. Send it to the blind. Send it to the lame. He goes, I'm overlooking the preachers and the pastors, and I'm looking for the prostitutes to make them prophets. I'm looking for the heroin addicts to make them prayer warriors. If you don't want the power, somebody else will. He says, I invited them, and they didn't want to come. Let me just... I'm trying so hard, Pastor Paul, to be nice. I really am. I'm trying so hard. The wedding's still going to go on if you don't come. See, when we send out wedding invites, when you get one back saying, I'm not going to make it, you don't cancel the whole wedding because one person doesn't want to show up. If I don't come to the prayer meeting, that church is going to fall apart. It's not going to fall apart. It's probably going to grow because you've been there. You've been stunting us from growth. Friend, here's the mentality. Here's the ungodly mentality that we have in the American church. If I'm not involved, God can't move still. I've said a billion, I've gotten stressed out. I've been preaching for 6 years at our revival. I've been traveling almost every weekend for about 5 years now. And I'm sitting there going, oh God, I'm stressed. And God goes, if you're stressed and you have anxiety and you're going there thinking, you still think it's about you, Isaiah. You have not realized that if you were to die today, I would find a replacement in a heartbeat. So you think this is all about you. Friend, the gospel's for you, but it's not about you. This whole thing is not about your comfort. It's not about your happiness. He said, I've come for the sick, not the healthy. And we're building churches to cater to the healthy when churches were never meant to cater. Jesus said the basic definition of what I came for is for the sick. He told the religious people, I did not come to babysit you. I did not come to beg you to come to the altar. He said, I came for those tonight that are depressed, that are suicidal, that are desperate, that are hungry, that have some urgency, that say, I need the presence of God. If you don't need more of God, then you came to the wrong place. I'm here tonight because I'm weak and I need God, because I've been asking and I'm ready to receive because I'm desperate. When you do this to come to the altar, you're not desperate. When it takes you more than 30 seconds to come to the altar, you're not desperate. When you have to think about and let the devil lie to you every week whether you should be at this altar, you're not desperate. That voice saying, don't go to the altar, that's not the voice of God. That's the devil himself. Well, I'm full of the Holy Ghost. Yeah, so is Adam and Eve, and they still listen to the snake. And some of you are spending more time letting the snake convince you than let God convince you. Because you know what blows me away? You've never once doubted the power of the enemy. You've never once said the devil's not real. Yet all the time, I don't know if God's still there. I don't know if God's power. You don't doubt the power of darkness. Why do you doubt the power of God? We need to stop doubting God and say, God, I've asked you, and tonight I'm expecting to receive. I didn't come to play games. See, when the baby's coming out, you have to learn to push harder. You don't slow down when the promise is being birthed. And some of you need to push harder. Some of you have gotten relaxed with revival. Some of you have gotten casual with the presence of God. Some of you have gotten comfortable in the anointing. And here's what God is saying. Get out of your comfort zone. Get out of your complacency. Get desperate. Get hungry. Say, God, tonight is the night where I push this thing out in prayer. Tonight is the night where I give birth to what you've called me to do.
I get the prayer team up, the praise team up. When Alyssa was pushing, I'm not trying to get too graphic here, and the head of the baby started coming out, the doctor didn't say, slow down, stop pushing. Some of you have stopped pushing for this thing. I'm family. If I was a guest speaker, I wouldn't talk like this. I'm family. I'm a part of this ministry. I'm an on-staff, off-staff evangelist. You've stopped pushing. I thought they would like that. You stop pushing. You're not desperate anymore. I remember the first night this revival broke out, and me and Pastor Paul stood on stage, and he said, can you come back next week? And there's something happening. And it was almost midnight, and nobody would leave. And now the moment we do it, 5 minutes at the altar, you're out. Got to go pick up the kids. There is nothing tonight that you have to do that is more important than getting a hold of the presence of God. I could care less about your stupid show about zombies that's full of the devil himself. I can care less about the new movie that just came out. Throw it all away tonight. What would happen if you got rid of every TV for a month? And instead of letting Netflix raise my kids, I'm gonna let the Holy Ghost raise my kids. Instead of letting the culture, oh, some of you young people are scared right now because you already know your parents are gonna take this away when you get home. I remember when I was back in church, my mom, preacher, you need to get on your kids' MySpace. Yes, MySpace. I'd be freaking out. No, I'd call my friend. You need to log on my MySpace. Delete everything. Delete it all, every comment, every message. Why? Because I was hiding. And I was coming to church, and I was faking it. Because you want to know why? That's what we teach people to do in the American church. We teach them how to be professional Christians. Here's how to praise when you're in sin. What if we prayed in secret as much as we sinned in secret? What if I told you, listen, friend, and I say this sober with the fear of God, and I could care less. People want to say, I have covering, I have spiritual authority, I have tons of pastors over me. But I'm going to say this, go ahead freely. There's judgment coming to this country. And here's the deal. There is not a revival in the world that's going to stop the judgment of God. Here's what revival does. It protects people from the judgment of God. God's not stopping judgment. God would have to pull Sodom and Gomorrah out of hell and apologize to them if he didn't judge America. 75 million documented babies have been murdered since 1973, and God says, for blood, I require blood. There is only one antidote to this whole thing. There is one end to this story, and that's the American church standing up saying, we are going to be the church that Jesus has called us to be. We are not going to be a church that caters to emotions. We're not going to be a church that caters to comfort zones. There's plenty of normal churches. If you want to go to one, there's one right down the road and right down the road and right down the road. We are going to be the house of the Holy Ghost. We are going to be the hospital, and we're going to push this thing out. And it might hurt and it might be uncomfortable, but when God does what he promised us to do, we'll forget about the pain. We'll forget about the effort. We'll forget about the work. But some of you need to push. You sitting there going, oh, this thing will just come out whenever it comes out. I wish my wife said, you push. And when that thing comes out, you don't sit there and go, oh my gosh, I don't know why they made me come to prayer every week. I don't know why they're making me give. You see that thing and go, this is why I gave. This is why. We are not here for no reason. The Bible says everything you do for God is not useless. In other words, it doesn't go void. Every praise, every shout, every time I lift my hands, something is happening in the supernatural realm. I didn't join this thing to waste my time and to come hang out with a bunch of hypocrites. I joined this thing because God said, Isaiah, there is real fire. There is real passion. There is real authority. There is real power in my spirit. This is the same spirit that raised Christ. And, oh, I'm going to start running in this place. That raised Christ is living on the inside of you. You have the power. You have the authority. You have the anointing. You could ask. Let me end. Since I didn't get out of my intro, let me end here. Praise God. They know that's the truth too. God raised up a man named Noah. God says, Noah, I'm judging the earth. It does not matter how much you pray, Noah, I'm judging the earth. It does not matter how much you fast, Noah, I'm judging the earth. But I'm going to build an ark that's big enough for anyone that wants to come in to come in. And guess what? Judgment's coming, but you have a chance to escape the judgment. And in my opinion, the scariest... You know what happened when Noah started preaching? Everybody laughed at Noah. Oh, here's Isaiah again. Here we go. Can tell us about our sin and judgment and hell and fire. We're all going to hell. None of us are saved. Go delete Netflix. Throw out all my TVs. He's been telling this for a year and a half. Yet you still have it in your house. See, it's proof that the word hasn't taken effect in your life. A year and a half I've been in this revival, and I'm still not witnessing to people. And I'm still, friend, if you've been in this thing since the beginning, and there's no works in your life, you've missed everything we're doing here. There's no change. Change. The devil doesn't mind you falling, he minds you changing. He doesn't want you to change. Noah's preaching, everyone's laughing. What did Noah preach on? Judgment and righteousness. Noah said, judgment is coming, and he preached righteousness, and he invited whoever wants to come in the ark to get in the ark. You know how many people came into the ark that he invited besides his family? Zero. What does it mean? It means God will still judge a country that says no, and that if revival breaks out and the American church decides they don't want it, God's not going to come back and say, okay, I'm going to rapture the majority. The majority were lukewarm. The majority were apathetic. The majority, God says, I'm coming for the remnant. The remnant might only be one family, but guess what? I'm not changing. Watch. I'm not changing my word to justify and to cater to the crowds. See, we think as long as all these big churches are doing this and doing that, God's okay with it. God has never been validated by numbers. God has been validated by obedience. God says, I don't care if the entire earth turns from me. I'm still coming back for a bride that is without spot, that is without blemish, that is without wrinkle. There is room in the ark. Who's the ark? Jesus. Live my life in the presence of God. Judgment's coming. Here's the saddest verse to me, one of them in the whole Bible. It says that Noah and his family got in the ark, and God closed the door behind Noah. And all those people that laughed at Noah, that said, Noah, you're too radical, got swept away in the floods of judgment. And here's what your Bible says in the New Testament. As in the days of Noah, so will the second coming of the Son of Man be. What was the days of Noah? Church is normal. Just keep having church. Let's ignore the fact judgment's knocking on the door and no one wants to talk about it. Let's ignore the fact that Leonard Ravenhill's gone, that David Wilkerson's gone, that these men who preach judgment, that preach the wrath, they're gone, long gone. And the Bible says this, to take note when godly men go to be with the Lord, because there is something coming upon this nation and God is raising up real prophets. I'm not talking about those that will give a little fortune cookie word and tell you how God wants to heal your ankle. I'm talking about those that will stand up behind the pulpit and will preach with the fear of the Lord and will preach with the passion and the fire of God, and those that will not tell you what your flesh wants to hear, but will tell you what your spirit needs to hear. I'm talking about those that will be bold as lions. I'm talking about those that will be desperate. I don't know about you, but I'm getting in the ark. I'm not going to miss this thing. I'm not letting the door close on me. If you're in this house tonight and you say, I'm done not pushing, I'm done being casual, I'm getting in the ark. I'm getting in the presence of God.
something to happen in my life, then you come to this altar and say, God, we'll stand in the gap. We're going to ask. We're going to push. Push harder. Push harder. The baby's coming. The baby's coming. Push harder. I see the head. Push harder. Something's breaking. Fresh start. Push harder. Push harder. Push harder. No breakthrough in my marriage. Push harder. No breakthrough in my family. Push harder. No breakthrough in my ministry. Push harder. I need the Holy Ghost. Push harder. Push harder. How bad do we want it? How bad do we want it? God, we need this, God. God, open up the ark. God, we need this country saved. God, we need revival. Come on, push. Push harder. Here it comes. Come on. What are you believing God for? What have you been asking Him? What have you been asking? Maybe you're between your ask and receive. Don't give up. Push. It hurts. Push harder. I'm tired. Push harder. I can't go any further. Push harder. I'm not going to make it, Isaiah. Push harder. I'm going back to the world. No, you're not. Push harder. We're not letting you go back. You've got nothing to go back to. Every bridge burned tonight. Every bridge burned. If God could give a 25-year-old and his family a $2 million orphanage in the Philippines, hand it to him because of the favor of God, you can push for this thing. If I could do what I'm doing, I'm the weakest person you'll ever meet. But I push hard. I don't play when it comes to God. Come on. Don't play. Some of you have given up. Don't give up. Right now, push. We're going to keep pushing. We're going to keep pushing. Something's breaking. Someone's body is getting healed right now. Cancer's going right now. It's time to receive. It's time to receive. Oh, God, we're hitting the ark tonight, God. If it's your first time, you put your hands up. Say, God, I don't even know what's happening, but I need you in my life. Friend, I was an atheist. I was at a service just like this. I said, God, I don't effing believe in you. I was cussing at God. And God said, that's the person I want to use for revival. I was a drunkard. I was an atheist. And God says, that's who I want to lead. I'll use to lead this revival. John 16, you have not asked. Some of you haven't asked yet. Ask Him right now. Fire. Right now, some of you are getting fresh fire. Come on, receive it. Fresh fire, fresh fire, fresh fire, fresh fire, fresh fire, fresh fire. Come on, fresh fire. Ask Him, fresh fire. Fire, God. Fire, God. Fire, God. Fire, God. Fire, God. Fire. Fire. Fresh. Push harder. Push harder. Come on. Push harder. There you go. There you go. Come on. Fire, God. Passion, God. Passion. 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 Come on, church. Push. We need this. We need this. Come on. We got to break through this next level. Come on. Push. Oh, come on, push. Come on, push. Fire. 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 Come on, all-consuming fire in this house. God, restore our first love, God. Father, we've stopped pushing. Some of us have stopped. God, restore our first love, God. Re-energize, God. Regenerate, God. Repentance tonight, God. Fire. Fire, receive it. Come on, right now. Fresh fire. Fresh fire. Fresh fire. Fresh fire. Come on, here it is. Here it is. Come on. Oh, Shanda, there it is. Come on, let it go. Oh, Shanda, there's Indiana. Fire. Fire. You're being marked right now for the nations. For the nations of the earth. Oh, Ramasandelebekia. Fire, God. If you're on the Fresh Start team, help me pray. If you're part of the leadership, help me pray there's fire right now. Keep pushing. I want every person in this room to push. Every person to push. If you're part of the leadership, help me pray. Fire, God. Fire, God. God, we need you, God. Spirit and power.
I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit, the Counselor, the Comforter, the one that will empower you, the one that will help you, the one that will comfort you. Come on, he says it's like childbirth. Don't get tired. You're just getting started. Come on. That kid's coming home. That marriage is getting healed. That body is getting healed. That community is getting saved. That coworker is coming to God. Come on, push for somebody else. This isn't for us. This is for the world. We're not getting the fire for us. We're getting the fire to go set this world on fire. It's time for us to leave the upper room and light the city ablaze. Say, God, bless me so I could bless others. God, bless me so I could bless others. Fire. Come on. Come on, the door of the ark is open. Come on. Get in Christ tonight. Come on, ask him tonight. This is your moment. Come on, ask for that fire. God, release that fire. God, we're begging you. God, release that fire. You said to come as beggars, God. We beg you. We cry out, God. We're not afraid to beg. Fire, God. Fire, God. Fire, God, over these young prophets. Fire over these young prophets, God. Oh, shandelebe shindelebe. Fire over these young prophets, God. Oh, shandelebe shindelebe. Mark them, God. Mark them for the ministry, God. Mark them for the nations, God. Oh, shandelebe shindelebe. God, as Jeremiah is, raise them up, God. No fear of man. Preach the word. Preach the word. As Paul told Timothy, Timothy, preach the word. God, raise him up, God. Put the word in him, God. Put the word in him, God. Put the word in him, God. Fire. 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 Release your power. Release your power. Release your power, God. Release your power. Release your power. Release your power. Release your power tonight. We're asking God. Come on. Come on, push. Come on, push. Yo, shandelebe kiyandele. Push. Release your fire. Release your fire. Mark them, God, right now. Every distraction, we break it. Every idol, we break it. Come on, break the idols. Break the idols. Robo bo bo shandele ki. Hey, robo bo bo shandelebe kiyandele ba. Fire, God, release it. Release your power. More conviction. More hunger. More desperation. Release your fire. Fire. Release your fire. Release your fire. More. 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 Release it. Release it. Release it, God. Release your fire. Release your fire. Release your fire. More. Fire! Release it, release it, release it, release it, release it. Release it, more God, more God, more God. Come on, as in the days of Noah, so will the second coming of the Son of Man be. Everyone was eating and drinking like everything was fine. Friend, it's time for a wake up. Come on, church. It's time for a wake up awakening. It's time for a radical awakening in the American church. Fire, God. Fire, boldness, God. Boldness over my sister. Boldness, God. Come on, put your hands up if you've slowed down. If you say, Isaiah, I'm not pushing the way I used to push. I want you to put those hands up right now. Another wave's coming. This is not for us. This is for the world. I feel like the Holy Spirit saying tonight's a fresh start in this revival. It's a fresh start in this revival.
Some of you have put down the mantle. Some of you have got back. You went back to normal. You went back to normal. You hear me? You went back to normal. You still come to revival, but you're not living revival. You went back to how it used to be before this revival. Right now, God says it's time to sign up again. Come on. Say, God, I'm not going to stop pushing. Maybe I stopped. Maybe I got tired. Maybe I'm in between my ask and receive. But I'm getting in the ark tonight. I'm not playing games anymore. I'm putting down the games. I'm putting down the patty cake Christianity. I'm putting down the lukewarmness. My heart has grown cold. He says, strengthen what little remains and is about to die. This is life or death, friend. This is life or death. You got to cry out like it's life or death. There's too much at stake to be normal. There's too much at stake to stop pushing. The enemy wants this church to stop pushing for what God wants to do. The devil is a liar. We're not stopping. I said the devil is a liar. We're not stopping. We're just getting started. Come on. Couple more minutes. Come on. There's something happening. Marriages are being healed as we pray. Bodies are being restored. Right now as we pray. Come on. Some of you need to learn how to cry out. You've never cried out before. This is a great night to start. God, we've lost our first love, God. Bring us back to you, God. We've lost our first love, God. God, I repent on behalf of the American church. God, we've left our first love, God. Father, we need your power back in the American church. God, forgive us for substituting the presence of God for popularity. God, forgive us in the American church. America, God, has turned their back on you. But tonight we turn back to you, God. God, we say we repent on behalf of America. God, hold back judgment, God. Give us more time. God, we're going to share. We're going to go into the harvest, God. We're not going to make excuses. We're going to make disciples. The Lord's given us time. Come on, church. A couple more minutes. Push. 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 We got to break the barrier that's holding us back. We cancel every lie of the enemy. We cancel every assignment of the enemy. We cancel Jezebel's assignment on your marriage. We cancel Delilah's assignment to try to make you casual, Samson. To try to make you comfortable, Samson. Fresh start. This is our fresh start for this revival. Oh God, we need you tonight. As in the days of old, God, they used to cry out, God. God, this generation's lost their cry. God, teach us to cry out like the days of old, God. God, take us back. God, take us back to the ancient paths, God. Father, we used to be desperate, God. Father, we used to be desperate, God. Father, we've lost our desperation. God, we've lost our passion, God. God, restore the joy of our salvation. God, we don't want our pleasure to come from movies and music, God, and culture. But God, we want our pleasure to come from your kingdom. God, forgive us, God, for living our lives in front of a television screen and escaping godly reality, God. We've ignored the call. We've ignored the supernatural. God, remove every distraction. Ask him right now. Come on, this is the last thing I want to pray. Rip out every distraction. Rip out every distraction. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Don't ask. Don't think about it. Get rid of it. Everything that has distracted you from the presence of God. I really like it. Get rid of it. I really like him. Get rid of him. If it's distracting you, get rid of it. Tonight. tonight, I feel like the clock is ticking. God says, get rid of it tonight. He does not want to pass you by. He does not want to find a replacement for you, but he will if he has to. If you don't want to come to the wedding, it's still going to happen with or without you. But I refuse to stay home and live normal when I could join the wedding banquet of the King. I refuse to eat at the table of this world when I could dine with royalty. I'm accepting the invitation to live a lifestyle of revival. The choice is yours. Will you accept the invitation tonight? Let's put our hands up one more time, one more time. In the next 7 days, God, I'm going to open up my mouth about you. Watch what happens when you begin to tell people about the God they were born to meet. They don't want to hear about it. That's a lie. The Bible says the labor is a few, but the harvest has been ready. It's always be ready. There's so many people I've recently witnessed to, and I'm thinking, I cannot believe that guy received it the way I never thought. Friend, I'm telling you right now, you ask God the next 7 days, make a commitment. Make a commitment in the next 7 days. I'm going to tell somebody about this God. I'm tired of not having any fruit in my life. Why? Because here's how John 16 ends. He says, ask and you shall receive so that your joy could be made full. I'm tired. I'm depressed. I'm weary. It's because you're not asking, you're not receiving, so you have no joy. Friend, the thing that motivates us to keep doing this thing called Christianity is answered prayer. It refuels your tank. If you're not seeing prayers answered, you're running on reserve. And you're going, I don't know why I just can't go anymore. Because there's no gas in the tank. How do I get gas in the tank? I see prayers answered. I pray and say, God, I need to start casting out devils. What is stopping me? I'll tell you what. This is what's holding you back. Can you imagine on Judgment Day, God goes, iPhone 7 Plus? That stopped your call? For Adam and Eve, it was a fruit. For you, it was an iPhone. For the children of Israel, it was a golden statue. And you laugh at them going, what idiots. They dance around a golden idol. God goes, you dance around an iPhone. They dance to earrings. You dance around phones. Netflix is what stopped the call of God. Friend, you know how many days I've caught myself watching documentary? I'm going, 4 hours wasted and I did nothing for the kingdom of God. Legalism, it's not legalism, it's called holiness. Friend, when you fall in love for real, you go, God, I don't want nothing else. I don't want nothing else to captivate me. I don't want the tentacles of this culture. Guys, I came in here, I had a word, I was going, God, I want encouragement. And God goes, no, Isaiah, we gotta get back. Guys, we've lost it in the church. We've made this entire thing about culture. It's about kingdom. We're not like the world. Jesus said, I'm sending you as sheep among wolves. And if they can't tell the difference between whether we're a sheep or a wolf, we've missed it. Nobody looks at a wolf and sheep and goes, I don't know, I can't tell the difference. It's clear. And God goes, that's how I want you to look. When you get in the culture, I want people to look at you and go, you're different. Everybody else is out eating each other alive, and you're loving and you're caring and you're nice and you want to talk with me. You're not like, but if we're like the world, then all of this does not matter. Yeah. Paul says all we're doing is deceiving ourselves. Because if Christ didn't rise, we've missed the mark. And if Christ rose, then we're called to rise with him. And if I'm living my life Sunday to Sunday, obsessed with the things of this world, going to the same things and movies and culture, I'm missing the mark. And friend, you stand before God, God's gonna say, you heard it every week at your church. You have no excuse not to go home tonight. And here's my challenge, 7 days share your faith and go home tonight and get rid of something. Well, I don't know what to get rid of. I do. You want me to tell you what you should get rid of? Laptops, phone, whatever is in your way, get rid of it. And yes, don't go sell your Xbox. Don't go sell your Wii, just smash it. We don't sell idols, we destroy idols.
Don't go sell your flat screen. Smash it. I give you permission, grown man. If you're spending 4 hours a day, go smash it. Because Jesus said, you're better off entering heaven with one eye than hell with two. Pluck out your eye. That's what Jesus said. It was not a parable. It was not a story. He said, literally, if there's something causing you to stumble, I feel this under the power of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, this is God. Then God says, get rid of it. I don't care if you're a pastor. I don't care if you're a worship leader. I don't care who you are. I don't care if your name's Isaiah Saldivar. If there's something in your life, I was telling Pastor Sean today, I said, Pastor, there's never been a moment where I've got to God and said, God, what do you want me to change? And God goes, you're good. You're perfect. Don't change anything. Ask him and he'll show you what you need to change. Every time I come to him, he says, Isaiah, I don't like this. I don't like, every time I hear the word, tomorrow morning when I hear the word, it's gonna challenge me. And I'm gonna leave tomorrow morning, and guess what? I'm gonna repent and I'm gonna change before I get back tomorrow night. Why? Because the word of God is sharp and it wants to pierce you. Put your hands up right now. I wanna pray one last thing. Father, I just ask you tonight, God, to wound us. God, we have gone so long without being pierced by the word. God, wound our hearts. God, convict us. Make us uncomfortable, God, with our sin. I pray that you would get in front of that same movie and go, oh, I feel gross watching this. I pray that you would think about the alcohol, the beer, it's just one drink. I don't care. I pray you would think about it and go, oh, that's disgusting. Friend, your new relationship with Christ gives you a new relationship with sin. And it's this, I hate it because it separates me from God. I'm not legalistic. I want more of God. And if this is in my way, then God, I'm getting rid of it. God, I pray tonight. I pray tonight, God, that we would push like we've never pushed in this revival. I pray, God, that it would not just be the preacher that goes home with no voice, but every single one of us would go home with no voice. God, that every time we came before you, we gave 100%. God, the same way we gave 100% to the bar, the same way we went hard for the club, the same way, God, we went all out for the enemy. God, I pray that your church, God, will begin to labor harder for you than the gang members labor for their gang. I pray, God, that we would be more addicted to your presence than the drug addicts are in this city addicted to heroin. I pray, God, that you would raise us up, God, and that we would be radical, God, that we would break the norms, God. God, even this idea that I got to come and hear a good word. God, shatter that. I don't want to hear a good word. I want to be challenged by your spirit, God. I want to be convicted to the core. Yes. God, I pray some in this room you'd raise up, God, as Jeremiah's, that would preach, God, with such a prophetic anointing, God, that people, God, would fear you again, God. Father, we've lost, God, we've lost the fear of God. Father, I ask you tonight, you would give us back the fear of the Lord. God, this is not a game. This is not a joke. You really shed blood so that we could freely enter your presence. God, I ask you tonight, give us the fear of God. Because when we get the fear of God, we don't want nothing else. God, we don't want the culture. We don't want the status quo. God, I'm asking you tonight, God, that you would awaken our hearts, God, that we would push, God. Come on, church. Let's just pray for 60 more seconds. What is God putting his finger on tonight? What is God putting his finger on tonight?
Come on, let's, oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Isaiah, for the word tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the word tonight. Lift your hands. Come on, Jessica, get ready. We've had a renewing of our vows tonight. That's what I felt the Lord spoke down there. We've had a renewing of our vows intimately with him, personal intimacy with the Lord, but also a renewing of our vows for carrying the revival. Come on, fresh start. Are you in the room right now? Come on. Lift up your hands and let's go to intercession. Come on, y'all get ready. You ready? Lord, tonight we have renewed our vows, oh Lord God. We press hard around here, but we have been challenged tonight, oh God. Lord, that there is a next level, that there is another dimension, that there is another phase that you are taking us into. Lord, we thank you now, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you have equipped us with everything we need, Lord. And we draw on that in the Spirit tonight. Eye is not seen, ear is not heard, mind cannot conceive. prepared for us, that you reveal it by your Spirit, oh God. And we draw on your Spirit tonight, Lord God. And we renew our vow with you, Lord, in this house, to carry revival to a city, Lord God. To carry revival to a state, oh Lord God. To carry revival to a region, Lord God. Come on, Fresh Start. You know how we pray. Let the atmosphere that is in this room right now, God, Lord, whether anybody is listening, Lord, over the airwaves or not, let the atmosphere in this room, Father, be contagious. We pray in the name of Jesus. But before that, God, let our hearts connect with you. Let fire touch our hearts tonight. Let it be contagious, we pray in the name of Jesus. I pray for a contagious fire, a contagious fire.
Till he comes.
shout of praise in the house tonight. Come on, somebody ought to shout. Release a sound in this place that's going to cause the angels of heaven to shout with you. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, Isaiah, that was so awesome, my friend. So powerful. God is raising up a revival remnant that are going to be so passionate about the presence of Jesus. They will be legalists because they are willing to